For centuries, in the rolling hills around the town of Parma, air-dried hams have been prepared with passion and skill passed down the generations. This tradition and the unique climate of the Parma area have produced one of Italy's most celebrated foods, prosciutto di Parma. Prosciutto di Parma, or Parma ham, is unique in many ways. Its production is steeped in tradition and inextricably linked to the land where it's produced. To avoid climatic variations, impairing the quality of Parma's prized ham, the boundaries of the production area are strictly controlled. The area is limited to below 900 meters on the Parma hills, as above the winter is too cold and too long. And a 5 kilometer distance from the Via Emilia with the Po River's humidity and fog. To the east, the boundary is the Ense River, and to the west, the Stirone River. Beyond these, local culinary traditions change, and higher mountains protect the land from the sea breeze. On certain days, farmers say they can smell these sea breezes. A gentle wind blows from the south, and the warm sea air climbs the mountain passes and then rolls down into the valley among the chestnut trees. So, for the last 2,000 years, in this small area, Parma hams have been cured slowly and naturally. Through the centuries, knowledge advanced and traditions developed. Breeding and farming techniques became more refined, and the meat from the pigs became increasingly sweet and tender. Valuable and complex knowledge passed from father to son. Generations of men working in harmony with the surrounding nature. This is the great Parma ham tradition. In 1963, 23 Parma ham producers founded the Consorzio del Prosciutto di Parma, the Parma Ham Consortium. Since then, the consortium has strived to safeguard Parma ham's unique quality and traditional production methods. Now the consortium has 180 members. Under the consortium's rules, producers must produce Parma ham naturally, without additives, according to its ancient tradition. This process has a long curing period and requires great patience, skill and care. The consortium's efforts to defend the traditional production led to the Italian government issuing a specific law relating to Parma ham. And more recently, it was awarded the protected designation of origin, meaning that no other air-dried ham may use its name. An independent certifying body, the Istituto Parma Qualità, checks correct observance of the consortium's rules. Specifications are increasingly strict. Parma ham needs salt, air, and a lot of time. At least 12 months curing. Nothing else is added to produce it. The men of Parma are crucial to its history and tradition. Men who can instantly recognize good pork legs. Men who've learned how to trim the hams by hand. And the men known as master salters. A great skill in knowing exactly where to apply less or more salt so that just enough is used to cure the ham and retain the sweet flavor. After 100 days of constant cold and humidity, the hams are brought into the big maturing rooms. Here they remain for 3 months. Large windows are open and closed to allow the countryside air to circulate or protect the hams from the sun. This land has a precious microclimate. Summers are airy and dry. Winters are cold but never freezing. Humidity is never excessive, and a perfumed air blows from the hills. 7 months into the process, sugnatura, a mixture of pork fat and pepper, is applied by hand to the uncovered surface of the meat to soften and protect it. Hams are now moved to the cantina, cellars where they remain for a minimum of 5 months. Here the hams dry slowly under the close supervision of the producers. Only a trained sense of smell can recognize quality and detect defects. The spilatura, with a horse bone needle, is an important test to determine whether a ham has cured perfectly and can be worthy of the title Parma ham. After the final test, the legs are firebranded with the ducal crown, which bears 5 points and the name Parma. Only now is it an authentic Parma ham. It's a long and complex process to make a Parma ham, and the story of each ham is impressed on its skin. The first mark is an indelible tattoo, which is branded onto each hind leg of the piglet by the breeder. This carries the farm's identification code and the pig's month of birth. A second mark is added at the slaughterhouse. The initials PP are fire-branded onto the pork legs, signifying they are of sufficient quality to enter the Parma ham production line. On entering the curing house, a metal seal bearing the consortium code is added to the legs, detailing the month and the year of the beginning of curing. And finally, after all verifying marks are checked and all regulations have been observed, the leg is branded with the ducal crown. Underneath the crown is the code of the producing firm. Only the consortium's ducal crown guarantees a Parma ham. It means all traditional methods have been respected, and it's a 100% natural, light, and unique product. And the best way to enjoy Parma ham? Well, as the Parma people do, simply on its own. Each succulent and wafer-thin slice has the fragrance of country air and a salt-sweet taste without rivals. Guaranteed by the Consorzio del Prosciutto di Parma.
Io sono nato nel 1907, l'11 novembre, ad Anghilano. Ho cominciato a lavorare, a fare questo mestiere che avevo 14 anni. Mio padre aveva una trattoria e nella trattoria ho cominciato a vendere il prosciutto. Andavamo nei piccoli macelli qui nel Parmense e si comprava i prosciutti, poi li portavamo a Anghilano, si mettevano sui tavoli e si cominciava a fare il sangue, si rifilavano, poi con una tenaglia si faceva l'osso. Poi si mettevano sui banconi e lì si salavano. A salsa facevano il sale nelle terme e allora si mescolava col sale marino. Ma poi a salsa hanno smesso e allora hanno adoperato solo il sale marino e di cava. si salavano e li mettevano dentro nella cella. I banchi restavano lì sotto sale 20-22 giorni. Quando poi erano salati si levava il sale e si mettevano nelle celle, chiamiamole celle di riposo. Allora si faceva la lavorazione solo in inverno, quando era marzo-aprile, sospendevano e riprendevano in novembre, ecco. Allora si andava con la stagione naturale. Si nevicava e faceva freddo, allora andava bene, altrimenti erano disastri. Le celle sono tutte dal 1927. C'era una cella frigorifera grande e si lavorava solo in quella cella lì. Si prendevano dalle celle di riposo, si portavano fuori quasi all'aperto e lì si lavavano con l'acqua calda. Allora andavamo a legna con dei focolai lì e si lavavano con le spazzole bene. Poi si appendevano al sole. Ecco, lì poi rimanevano fino a sera, poi li mettevamo negli stanzoni a asciugare con aperto le finestre, secondo la stagione, se era bella o brutta, ecco. Negli stanzoni le scalere erano fatte come queste qui, allora erano tutti di legno, ecco. Dal 26 o dal 27. Quando abbiamo fatto le celle hanno inventato anche le scaliere, perché prima si appendevano tutti accanto ai chiodi del pavimento, insomma. E gli stanzoni erano sempre al di sopra della cantina, con delle finestre larghissime perché girasse l'aria, quando poi tirava il vento piaceva ancora di più. La sugna si dava un po', non come adesso, poco attorno all'osso e basta, quando dallo stanzone si mettevano giù in cantina, quando erano quasi stagionati. Dopo poi veniva la selta in settembre e allora si cominciava a puntarli, quando venivano i milanesi, i salumieri, che poi li caricavano con i carrettieri che stavano via 8 giorni. Il prosciutto le mangiano molto volentieri. Ai miei tempi, quando ero giovane, lo mangiavano solo i signori, perché i poveri non avevano i soldi, ma piaceva a tutti. Sì, sempre piaciuto il prosciutto.